Welcome to Sistas Conversations Podcast with your hostess, Letrise Carter. We feature interviews in literary, film, and television, as well as real topics that impact the Black community.
Welcome to Sistas Conversations with Letrise Carter and my co-host, attorney Pillara Henderson-Smith. This episode, we will focus on debt and budgeting with our special return guest, Shawn Cook from Advocate Wealth Management.
For all our listeners, replays and downloads are available on YouTube, Speaker Radio, Spotify, iTunes, iHeartRadio, Google Podcasts, and Amazon Music. Follow and subscribe to our channels so you don't miss an episode. Welcome back to Sistas Conversations. Shawn Cook from Advocate Wealth Management Show. Welcome, Shawn.
Hey, thank you. Glad to be here.
Oh, we are happy to have you back. Got a couple questions from you for a couple of the fans. So I'll make sure we don't leave without it, even though I directed them to your website. I was like, well, maybe you might want to ask him this directly. But I told her, I'll ask him if we have time. I said, if we have time, because today's show is about debt. So just remind me that I have a guest that has a question for you before we jump off.
Perfect.
Okay. Okay, so I like to share some interesting facts. I was doing a little research these last couple of days, and before we jump in with our Q&A with you, Shawn, so the average American household has $90,460 in debt, according to the 2021 CNBC report. That includes all types of consumer debt products, from credit cards, personal loans, mortgages. Personal loans is 6%, mortgages is 7%, and the student loan debt increased to 12%. The impact of the pandemic for 2020, according to Experian, the unemployment rate went from 3.5% pre-COVID to a peak of 14.8% in April of 2020. Which is the highest it's been since 1948. The US consumer balance grew by $800 billion, according to Experian. I thought that was just, I was like, wow, I knew our debt grew, but I didn't know it grew that much. You know, when you start researching and reading and looking into stuff, you're like, wow, are we ever gonna get out of debt? It's the question.
Are we ever going to get out of debt? No, I don't think so. Unfortunately, I think our consumer culture predicates that we buy more than we make. So that kind of lends to the culture that we have of, you know, utilizing debt in a very negative way where it ends up hurting you in a lot of other ways. So.
Now, you know what I found where I got this chart. So, and they broke the debt out by generation. It's the average amount of debt by generation in 2020. Generation Z, ages 18 to 23, their debt is average $16,043. The millennials, ages 24 to 39, is $87,448. And then Generation X, which I fall into this generation, ages 40 to 55 is $140,643. And I'm like, wow. And then the baby boomers, of course, the ages 56 to 74 is $97,290, their average debt in 2020. And then the silent generation, they're calling them the silent generation, ages 75 and above, their debt is $41,281. Those numbers are scary.
I think part of it you have to take into consideration is that some of that's not bad debt, right? Like a mortgage is not necessarily bad debt. So the difference between the millennial and the Gen X that you just mentioned right there is probably a difference between millennials just having student loan debt at $87,000 and the Gen Xers mostly having, mortgage debt is what I would say. It's probably that mixture that's between those two. But yeah, some of that is, the credit card debt is the scarier debt, in my opinion, which we'll get into as we get further into the Q&A here.
Okay. Awesome. Well, again, welcome back to the show to talk to us about debt and budgeting.
Yeah, welcome, Shawn. So it's funny, Letrise, I fall into that Gen X generation as well. So maybe listening to Shawn's explanation a little bit, maybe is a little consoling. We have more things and not necessarily more bad things, but just more debt. But looking at baby boomers and silent generation, I mean, it dips a little, but it doesn't completely go away. That is a little bit alarming to me, a tiny bit. Shawn, what about you? Is that like, looking at those numbers and seeing it, yes, you know, you kind of build up. So if you're 24 or so, and you just have student loan debt, you haven't, you know, purchased a house or cars and that type of thing, so you don't have much. But then once you hit that retirement age, you still have close to $100,000 worth of debt.
Yeah, so again, I think part of what you have to consider that we're not seeing with these numbers is also asset level. So I would be curious as to see not only what the debt level is, but then what assets you have to counteract the debt. So if we looked at overall net worth, I think you would see like the millennials probably have $87,000 in debt, and they maybe have like a negative $85,000 net worth, right? But as you go up that chart, even though you might see more debt, so you've upgraded from a house for one child at the age of 30, right, to, you know, kids and grandkids, and now you've got the bigger home, you've upgraded. So you see the debt increase with the purchases that you're making. So, you know, you're not usually buying a $500,000, $600,000, $7,000 house out the gate, but you'll buy that later on in your 50s. So you'll see a bigger debt on that end, but you'll also see they have retirement income saved up for, and they have pensions or other things that the younger generation doesn't have. So yes, concerning. Because again, part of the problem is that we're always trying to keep up with other people and we're always overspending what we're making. But I think if we were to see like a net worth chart, it would console us a little bit more. not entirely, because some people are making those purchases and not having any assets still, they're just making bigger purchases. It should very much concern those people.
So it makes sense. So we need a total picture is what you're saying. So don't just take the numbers blindly. You need a total picture. So hopefully as we get through some of this Q&A today, at least as we talk about budgeting and debt and stuff, we can tackle a little bit of that and help to see a bigger picture and see some light at the end of that tunnel, right?
Yes.
Or a rainbow approach here. All right. So then let's just jump into these questions here. So Letrise and I have quite a bit for you today. So be on your toes, right?
I'm ready. I'm always ready.
Okay. So this first one is, what is a money map? Whenever, you know, you hear about budgeting and debt and stuff, like you hear that term a lot, a money map. So we're just going to assume that all of our listeners have no idea about any of this and very, you know, just basic lay here. What is that?
So, I've heard money map can be used in multiple ways. I mean, you could have a roadmap for your financial plan on different steps that you're trying to take. You could have a money map that's budget related. So let's focus for today's purposes on like a budget. So the money map is where you're spending your money, how you're spending your money, and kind of what percentage you're allocating to all the things that you have going on. And I think where people kind of get out over their toes, to use a skiing term for whatever reason that came to me. I think the problem is they usually end up putting a larger percentage towards things that they shouldn't, like their rent payment, like they get a bigger place than they should or a nicer place than they should, a bigger car or a nicer car because they went on what they could afford, quote unquote, rather than what they should afford, right? Rather than what they should have been purchasing. So the money map is really just kind of your strategy on spending.
Okay. So kind of on that money map then, so you said people kind of get into this place and they spend more than they should on certain items. Is there a recommendation of, okay, your mortgage or your rent payment, it should only be X amount of percentage of what you're bringing in monthly? Is there something?
I think there are some basic numbers out there that you could kind of go off of, but I think the problem with a lot of those basic numbers, even from our last conversation, I prefer to have a tailor-made solution rather than a general rule of thumb, because certain people are going to find other things more important. If you're a homebody, are you going to spend more money on your house than you are dining out and doing all the traveling and some of the other things? Yes. So maybe your percentage of what you're spending would increase on your home as opposed to somebody else that they're using it as a place to sleep. And maybe now during the pandemic, they've had to work there, but it hasn't really been the place that they're going to spend all their time. So I think it's going to be predicated a little bit more on your what you have going on in your life and what matters to you. But yes, from a general perspective, there are basic numbers. So like on your home, you wouldn't want it to be more than 25% of what your net income is. And I think that number for a lot of people is probably almost double that number. So I think that's one of the instances that a lot of people come in and they say, hey, I've been approved for X amount of loan. I can go out and buy this big house. And, you know, you need to kind of go back to the drawing board and say, what percentage of my income is that? And should I get a house that big? Because what happens if now I get this house and there's a $12,000 mishap on the house that I have to fix? Well, I didn't leave enough savings in my income to cover that. So now I'm in big trouble because I, again, got over my toes on the expense up front.
Wow. Okay. So I think I like your approach of everything being unique. But just kind of having those ballpark numbers in place, I think it's a great place for people to start. At least they sort of have an idea to say, okay, so I shouldn't probably be over 25%, but let me look at what I'm actually spending, what's actually important to me. So that just sort of brings me to then, how do you prioritize your bills then? So it's, I mean, obviously you sort of just started that. So how would you prioritize?
Great question. And I think this is probably the one thing most people don't do. So I start every financial planning conversation with my clients with what matters. And I think you have to get out of your own consumer mindset. So, you know, when you see somebody with the new iPhone that just came out or the new Apple Watch or the new whatever that just came out, something inside of you clicks and says, ooh, I want that too. Or do I need that? And now you start down this rabbit hole that you're not even intentionally trying to go down. We're now, as you see it more and more and you think about it more and more, it kind of like itches its way into your wallet. And you start thinking about spending on something that if you went back to the drawing board and said, does this matter? You probably would have said no, but now you haven't created a baseline to start with. So for me, the first thing I ask is, what are your priorities in your own life? What are the things you're saying matter? So I have clients kind of go through and create a top six list. Whether that's your family, your faith, your finances, traveling, you know, hobbies, whatever those top things are for you, creating a base case for yourself of if push came to shove, what am I picking as my main priorities? And from there, crafting a list of goals that are both financial and non-financial that are associated. So let's say, I'll pause there and kind of give an example. Let's say in your list of items, you put on health. Is like number three on your list. And then you're coming down to looking at your budget and you see that you've spent $1,000 on restaurants this month and $20 on your gym fitness membership price. And you know those restaurants aren't good for you and they're not leading to your health. And you know that gym membership you use twice. So are those really your priorities or have you been living upside down again based on convenience, based on your emotions, based on not the things that you value, but the things that you're feeling in that moment. So it kind of brings you back to this drawing board of letting you let the budget tell you where you're kind of missing the mark on what you think matters in life. Does that make sense?
It totally makes sense. I love the idea of coming up with the priorities and then basing the goals off of the priorities and then actually looking to see, okay, what am I really spending? And is it in alignment with that? There's a lot of accountability in that, a lot of self-accountability in that. And if you're working with someone, it's really easy for them to look at it and be able to hold you accountable too, or question, you know, is this important or not really important?
Well, and it makes cutting things out of your budget a heck of a lot easier. I think upfront, most people think, I don't have anything to cut. I need all this. And when you go through this exercise, and so to be honest, I start one layer deeper than this, which is what is your purpose in life? I want to get you in the right mindset. Why are you here on earth? Okay, now that we're thinking through why are we here? What are our priorities while we're here? Okay, now that we have our priorities in mind, what are the goals that we want to set in place? Short term, intermediate term, long term. Okay, now let's look at the budget. Are we living according to what we just laid out? And most of the time, the answer is no. So then we can easily go through and be like, all right, if we want to flip this upside down and get to the priorities we listed, rather than if we audited ourselves the priorities we've been living, how can we flip that script? That's what we spend our time doing in the budgeting process, is reorienting your life to who you really are, not to kind of what society has been pushing you towards.
I love that. So what I'm really liking about Advocate Wealth right now, it is a very holistic approach. And so it's not just, okay, I need to save whatever, and then you give them this little quick thing that might work for the moment, but it's not an overall plan, an overall life plan, right? So it's not sustainable. So I really like that. Now, when you are working with clients, and once you get to the place that you prioritize things, and you know it's pretty set, or they're sure of what it is, what happens if they sit down and look at the numbers and they just don't have enough income coming in? Like, what do you advise? How do they tackle that?
Well, there's two routes, and only two routes. Make more money for the household, or spend less money for the household. Now, the key word I'm using that a lot of people are going to miss is for the household. And I think, again, we make a lot of decision based on comfort. So we're willing to go $50,000, $60,000 in credit card debt because we're unwilling to change something that is a comfort. So you could bring someone into your house to live in another room and take rent in and make up that gap, right? That would be an example of something. Now you have to be careful about who you're inviting to your home. Everyone's circumstance is different. However, there are other routes that may not be the perfect case for you, but we're not working with perfect. We're working with what you have.
Right.
So you kind of got to analyze the situation and be realistic about, hey, we got to move neighborhoods. Maybe we got to invite someone to come stay in our home. Maybe I need to go live with my parents. Maybe I need to. So there's a lot of questions that need to kind of go. Maybe the easy answers aren't what you want to hear, aren't going to be good enough. So you have to dig a little deeper. And I end up ruffling feathers with, hey, if we really want to make headway, these are the things we're going to have to do. And I know you don't want to hear that, but this is just comes down to, again, your priorities. You told me this was important. This is what you need to do if that is important. If it's not, that's fine. We just need to go back and reorient what we're saying matters.
Okay. So it sounds like some sacrifices have to come in there if you're really serious about tackling your issues.
Usually there's at least a few sacrifices involved in getting things going. But I think, again, if you looked at the grand scheme of the world and how money is spent, it wouldn't be necessarily considered a sacrifice if you lived in other countries or in other areas. But here, because we have so much, yes, it feels like I have to sacrifice my Starbucks every morning. Oh my gosh, how am I going to live? Not spending $8 on a coffee, right?
So. Yeah, I said first world issues that, yeah, you really need to keep perspective about. That's definitely one of them. Absolutely one of them. Okay, so this is kind of a more of a broad question, but I know sometimes people really tackle with this, the savings portion of this. So we're talking about like really tackling the debt, but you know, Americans, we don't really have savings either. And so sometimes this whole idea of saving just kind of seems to be this abstract concept for people. And so I'm just wondering, do you advise while you are figuring out your debt to also begin to save, or do you tell your clients, no, let's get the debt portion out of the way first and then we'll look at a savings?
For sure, we need to save first. Unfortunately, that's the hard part. You have to have a layer. I actually just had a meeting this week with a client. We built a buffer. There was a death in the family. Someone else wasn't doing their planning, so there was no life insurance. So this, which was a sibling of theirs, had to come out of pocket $12,000.
Oh,
wow.
To pay for funeral expenses that they weren't expecting, right? So without the buffer that we put in place, that would have been credit card debt.
Oh, wow.
Yes.
So things like that that aren't being considered, right? That's why you need a buffer. And what I generally try to do when the main thing we're working on is getting out of debt, then I try to build in at least 1 month of expenses. And I think people underestimate what that number is. Oh, well, yeah, that's like $3,000 or $4,000. But when we pull the budget together, I don't know that most people are in that range. It's probably closer to $7,000-$8,000 a month that's getting spent on everything from your housing, your car, your insurance, your food, your gas, you add it all up and it ends up being a much bigger bucket. So you need to have at least 1 month set aside. So that usually is enough to take care of a bigger like car expense.
Okay.
something happens with the house, something happens to your family, you need to take an emergency trip, you lose your job. So it's not a big enough bucket to necessarily cover you for the job loss, but at least gives you a little bit of a buffer if something happens. Once we're done with credit card debt, in my world, then we build a 3-month bucket. So the first bucket, when credit card debt is the main focus, 1 month. Outside of credit card debt, now when we're working on student loans, your mortgage, and all the other things that you might have kind of miscellaneously out there that are lower percentage debt. So we're talking like under that 5%, under the 4% mark. Then we can start focusing in on getting up to a 3-month buffer, which is where you really need to be, and then really pouring every other cent towards the debt.
Okay, that makes a lot of sense. So it sounds like, you know, it's one of those things where you think, I need to get all the bills out of the way, and then I'll think about the savings. But when you have these incidents that happen, what really happens is that it puts you deeper in debt, which makes it that much harder, you know, a lot more difficult to get out of debt. And so you really have to look long-term and really plan ahead. And so it may not sustain you, you know, for very long, but it would at least give you a little cushion to help recover.
Correct. And I think you want to stay out of that vicious cycle. And the way to do that is build a buffer between that cycle coming back for you.
Okay.
So that's the way to think of it, is like, this is my little, like, you know, this is my shield against having to go back down that hole of more and more debt. Mm-hmm. We want to see your net worth. We want to grow, even if it's just by getting rid of debt. That technically grows your net worth, to think of it that way.
Okay.
So that's kind of the focus of building that buffer.
Okay. So in the world of things are looking good, so you've kind of got a little bit of buffer in there, you're tackling the debt, you sort of have a plan, but you don't have a lot, right? So there's not a lot of resources in there. What's your recommendation on saving for yourself, like retirement long-term, or putting money aside for your child's education? I've heard lots of different things, you know, about this, and just what's your take on that?
I think you can do both simultaneously, but I think your kids aren't going to plan for your retirement. Only you can do that. Your kids can pay for their own education at some point when they're adults. And we don't know really if the educational system will be what it is today. If, you know, I won't get too far into kind of how I think the price point of college is just escalating at a untenable rate. But I don't know that college will look like it does now in 20 years if you're just having your first kid. So that's a question mark, but your retirement is still going to need money. And guess what? Inflation is a real thing. So the cost of the dollar is only going to increase. So if you're not investing towards retirement, you're going to be way behind the eight ball by the time, if you wait until your kids are through college in your 50s and you're just starting out, which I have clients that have done that. It's a lot harder to catch up because of how compound interest works. It doesn't stack up that quickly. It needs time to grow. So time in the market is kind of the thing to think about. So if I have a little bit of leftover money,
mm-hmm.
right, or and I'm trying to decide how to save, I think you have to think of your future first. That does include your kids. So even if that's you building a taxable account, not even a retirement account, even if it's building an account that you can invest and save for tomorrow, but it's growing at a better rate than maybe a savings account.
Okay.
You can use it for retirement. You can use it for college if things go well. You can use it, so you can kind of be a little bit more of a utility knife as far as how you utilize it, but I do think you have to kind of put that money in your own name that you can utilize. Now if you put it in a 529 account, which is a, for those that are listening, it's a Bright Directions in Illinois plan, or a Bright Start plan in Illinois. That's how you kind of get a tax benefit saving for college for your kids, which is a great vehicle to utilize. However, if you put money in that you don't use for college, now it comes back out, now you're going to have penalties on that. So it isn't as flexible once it's in there. So you want to build that bucket when it fits into your budget, but I wouldn't necessarily say you should start there if you're not going to put into your own retirement or your own taxable bucket.
Okay, that makes sense. So it's kind of a take care of yourself, because you are definitely going to get old, right? You will definitely
yeah.
Here. There's necessities, right? Just basic shelter and food that we'll need to be able to pay for. So it makes sense to take care of yourself. But that doesn't mean completely neglect your child. So if you have some extra, right, depending on what type of account you have it in, it can also be there to help with college. But at the forefront it should really be making sure you have something for retirement.
Correct. You've got to have the bigger term mindset. Again, when you're 75, 80 years old, your kids have their own life that they're building, maybe in a different state. They may not be available to help you. And the question is, do you want what Medicaid will offer, or do you want to choose what your lifestyle looks like? So for my money, I'd rather choose my lifestyle. I'd rather plan in advance and choose the life I want rather than, you know, my life be predicated on what the government is willing to give at that time. And we have no idea what the future holds.
Right.
So I'd rather do my own planning up front and not count on the government being the one that's going to give me that sustaining lifestyle.
Completely makes sense. I want to sort of address this next question. This is really, I guess for me, it's really, really thinking about the Black community. So many in my generation, you know, and thereafter, who have gone to college, we end up with student debt. And so trying to figure out how do you get yourself from underneath all the student debt, right? It's a good debt because you've gone to college, you've gotten an education, and the whole idea is that you'll get a good job. But unfortunately, these jobs usually are never enough to really sustain yourself and to really pay off, you know, this debt. And yes, there's wonderful programs, you know, out there like the income-based repayment, things like that, and forever grateful for those things, right? Because you are able to continue to pay, but it never seems to go away when you pay like that. So I'm just wondering if you have any tips for a lot of people that may be in that place. How do you actually really tackle that debt?
So I think this goes back to that. Once you're out of credit card debt or you've got no credit card debt, now we're focused on student loans and we want to get out from underneath it to get that income back in our own pockets. I think, again, you have to think back to the lifestyle you're willing to live in order to accomplish that. And I think that's the question mark that you have to be willing to start with. The goal when we're paying down any type of debt, credit cards, student loans, et cetera, is to do a snowball effect. So let's say, for example, you went to 4 years of college and you've got $60,000 of student loans out there. Well, we are going to target one loan of maybe the 8 or 10 loans that you have out there. The other ones we are going to pay the minimum amount on, and we are going to overpay on one account until that one's gone. And then we're going to snowball that dollar amount to the next loan. Usually it's size related. So let's say one is $6,000, the first one you got. One is $2,000. Well, we're going to start on the $2,000 one because the minimum payment for that, we're going to roll to the next one. We can get done with that a lot faster than we can the $6,000 one. Mm-hmm. So we want that snowball effect to kind of help us pick up pace as we pay things down. So that doesn't matter what type of debt we're paying off. That's just kind of the normal stance we take on it. Again, depending on the percentage difference. If you're looking at one that's like $2,500 and $2,000, it's not a huge gap. One is a 7% interest, one is 4. Well, we're going to start with the 7.
Okay.
We're not even going to think about it. We're going to take that higher debt. And we're going to pay that. If it's a close enough amount, we want to start with the rate. But again, if there's a big gap between the amounts, we want to start with the lower one just because we'll get through it quick enough to tag that money towards the bigger ones once we're done with it.
Okay.
Does that kind of answer the question? I mean, there's no easy answer, unfortunately. It usually means giving up a little bit of something and putting a little extra towards one loan at a time to kind of come out from underneath that problem.
It does. It just kind of says, okay, you just need to take a smaller bite, you know, another way to look at it is like a smaller bite until it's just kind of gone. I mean, it sounds like you just need to start. And if you can start with the smaller ones and eliminate. I'm thinking about people who have consolidated.
I was just about to say that because I consolidated mine.
Because they get the idea of consolidate, then you've only got one. And so then it's good. And so I don't really know how you can't use really that same snowball effect with a consolidated loan.
You sure can't. Now it's basically a mortgage, right? And you're thinking of it more as a mortgage that you're paying off. Depending on your rate, that's not a bad thing. If you had a variable rate or if you had a fixed rate, it just kind of depends on where you found it. But I don't think all student loan debt is as bad as people think it is. Let me qualify that. If you've got a fixed rate of like 3.5% or 3%, what is your mortgage? But a fixed rate of 3.5%.
Right.
Right. If you've got a fixed rate of 7%, now we're in trouble. Because okay. that's where it never feels like you're paying anything off.
Right.
Right. So the percentage does make a difference on how high of a focus you need to put on paying it off. The higher the interest rate, you need to be very focused on getting out. It needs to be priority one. Like, do I need to get a second job? Do I need to have a side hustle? Do I need to, right? You got to be willing to have that conversation again about the comfort that you have.
Okay.
So it doesn't always mean spend less. Sometimes it means I need to make more. I got to get a better job. I got to get a second job. I got to maybe do something I love, but try to make it financially incentivized for myself to do it. So you got to be a little bit more creative. And again, the percentage is a huge reason why you okay. need to do that.
Okay. Totally makes sense.
Yeah. And I just realized my consolidated interest rate is 4.25.
4.25. So it's right in that area where it's questionable, right? Mm-hmm. So for me, I'm still focusing pretty heavily on it. But
okay.
again, if my student loan is fixed at 4.25 and I've got clients that have home loans that didn't get refinanced that are in the fives, yeah. Which one am I focusing on? The mortgage or the student loan at that point?
Student loan, yeah.
No, the mortgage.
Depending on how much of a loan it is. Now, if I've got $20,000 in student loan and a $300,000 mortgage, okay, now I'm still focused on the student loans, right? Because the gap isn't big. However, you need to have that mindset of what's it really going to cost me?
Right.
There's a cost to this loan. So you always want to be conscientious of what you're giving up, what's getting added on every year to that loan, right? So you got to be thinking through what is this costing me extra over the long haul that I want to get rid of.
Right.
Okay. That's good. That's really good. And that brings me to, okay, so are there any budgeting apps or web-based programs or other resources that you provide or that you would recommend for our listeners?
Yeah, so all of my clients utilize a software that I give. It's like an online portal for budgeting and tracking. It pulls in, it's an aggregator. So if you've used Mint before, it is a similar to Mint program. So for those of you that don't have an advisor that you're working with that isn't doing any of this stuff with you, you can utilize Mint and it tracks all of your expenses from all of your accounts. So it's kind of a way to have like a snapshot day to day of where you're at, what you're spending. So if like you've got a credit card and your partner has a credit card and you don't necessarily see your expenses, if you're both on this one Mint account, you can see every expense.
Okay.
So you know like, hey, together we spent way more than we thought on other stuff that we weren't tracking. So for me, that's one of the main resources is kind of having an aggregate of all the spending that's happening. And all the income that's coming in, you can have a very accurate look at what's happening. Usually that's still not enough for most people unless you're being very meticulous with it. So I think a second layer that I add is an editable Excel budget. So I have an editable Excel budget that I give out that I'm willing to give out to anyone that's listening to the podcast. If you guys want to just send them to me, I'll be more than willing to give them my spreadsheet that helps them track it by hand. So it's not only the income and expense, it tracks all of what you're spending on a regular basis, but also does like a net worth statement.
Okay.
So you kind of have like an Excel spreadsheet running ongoing that's editable that you can play with and tinker with if you're comfortable to kind of make it more, you know, affiliated with your lifestyle and how you're living. So I personally use both. I actually track all my bill pay on my Excel spreadsheet. That's how I go through every month and pay everything. And I highlight it and check it off of my list of to-dos and track, okay, what income came in this month? Okay, what did I put towards, you know, which accounts that I've got? So I utilize an Excel spreadsheet and a tracking software simultaneously.
Okay, that's good. That's a good idea. I use Excel. I have a budget in Excel. I, you know, and I know my bank does this thing where it categorizes everything. And lately it's been Amazon.
Yeah, the problem with that sometimes is you don't know what that is. So that's where like the tracking software, so what you can do on the tracking, the software that I use is you go in and allocate what it was for. So like you might have like four target purchases, one's groceries, one's clothes, one is right kids stuff. So you can go in and just change it and track exactly what you're normally spending. So how I help people budget, kind of going back to that, is taking a look back at the last 3 months.
Okay.
Every dollar that's been spent, what has it been spent on? That's your run rate. That's the 3 month run rate that I use to judge. Here's what we need to budget for the future. Here's where we need to start cutting. So if you go back and look at your last 3 months on your Excel spreadsheet, is it accurate?
Okay.
That's the hard part. Because what you put on there is like, I'm going to spend $500 on food every month. And if you go back and look and that's not accurate, it's not a budget.
Yeah.
So that's the problem with a lot of Excel spreadsheets. And that's why I pair them together. I can actually go in and track and then implement that into my Excel spreadsheet to kind of do my bill pay and track, am I on pace with where I want to be?
Okay. So
you can see if you're keeping with those priorities as well.
Yeah, and those goals. Exactly. And those goals that you set. Mm-hmm.
You got it. You
absolutely. Got it. So is there a strategy for those who want to pay off their debt? You might have answered this already. That includes, like, say, for example, your auto loan. I think you probably did. your auto and your student loans within a particular time frame. I have a friend who he said he wants to pay off his mortgage in 10 years, and they just bought a new house. They have a first house that is paid for that he paid off in 10 years. He did that one. Then they purchased a bigger house, so now they have two homes, but one's paid for, and they just got a new car. So he has a plan. He was like, well, I want to pay this off in 10 years. He's 45. Pretty much wants to make sure he pay off everything before he retires. And I said, well, is that realistic? And what would you advise him to do? Because now he has a brand new car. It's a truck. They have three kids and they have a new mortgage. It's a bigger house. So now he has, and then they have student loan debt. So how should he tackle that? Because he still has the first house, and I think they're going to rent it out.
So this is where it comes back to why I don't love general advice, right? Because like general advice has no idea what the percentages are in all of those things.
Yeah.
General advice has no idea what the disposable or discretionary income or expenses he has. So if he has extra room in his budget to put towards some of these things, then it might be realistic. Mm-hmm. It may not be realistic, where a lot of people are like, I want to do X, and they've got an extra $200 in their budget. That's it. Mm-hmm. So it's not realistic for how they're spending. So it really does come back to all the numbers that you just laid out have kind of, you know, a part to play in making a decision on where to focus, how hard to focus, how much extra can we put towards different things and other goals that they have, like saving up income. So if all of those rates are, let's say, again, I have no idea, 3.5%. If all those rates are 3.5% for all the loans that he has, then you got to decide which one to start with. They're all the same. How do we kind of create a target list on what to go down? But if they're varied, then again, like I said before, size matters and percentage. So kind of coming up with a strategy around the different size and percentage that he has on those loans.
Okay. See, I'm going to have to give him your information because I told him, I said, I'm going to ask this question, but I don't think it's going to give you what you need, you know, because he's trying to come up with a plan. And, you know, because now he doesn't have the second mortgage. And I was like, so that's income. So you can take that income and pay off your new mortgage. Correct.
That's part of what I'm saying. With that, what is the discretionary income? What do we have left over after all of the expenses are done? And when you build a budget, I haven't used this term yet, but you want to have like a zero based budget. So a zero based budget is where you plan to spend every dollar that comes in.
Okay.
Not necessarily on an expense, but maybe part of that is like, so for us, I'll give you an example for me. Every week, we go in and we make payments, and me and my wife talk about it every week, to retirement, to our trust accounts, to 529 plans. We have a strategy that is a part of our weekly plan. It could be a monthly plan, a biweekly plan, whatever works best for you. But that's a part of our zero-based budget. Mm-hmm. So here's what we have in income. I want every dollar to have a strategy. Okay. Every dollar is working for me, and either it's paying for something I've already purchased, like my home, or it's paying for things I haven't purchased yet, but I'm going to in the future, like savings or other things like that.
Okay.
So that's kind of
the strategy.
Having an idea of all that extra money, where is it going to go? And you can have a plan on exactly how you want to spend it.
Okay. I'm just going to send him your way so you can have a full conversation.
Perfect. I can do that.
Is living below your means just to pay off debt good advice? You know, this is another friend. She's like, well, I'm just going to live totally below my means so that I can just pay off all my debt. And that's her strategy that she's using. And she wants to know, is that a good strategy? Because someone told her to do that. So she's totally out of her comfort. She moved out of Naperville. She moved out of Naperville into the city. Looks like, okay, to pay less rent, cut her costs completely. I mean, when I say she's living, and she makes very good money, very, very good money, but now she's living, I tell her, I said, you know, there's a point, there's, you can live frugal, but when you start going below frugal, I don't think it's worth it. You're working and you're not really enjoying, you know, you still should reward yourself. So what would be your advice to her?
So my advice is living beneath your means in general is always good, period. How far beneath your means is a different question that comes back to, why are you here? So if you can still do the why are you here, what matters to you, and live beneath your means, fantastic. If you can't, like, let's say, for example, part of your priorities is community with your family and your friends. You can't go see them because it's not in your budget. You can't have time together. You can't pay for food. You can't do the things that kind of give your life purpose. Then it's time to reevaluate again how we're spending. So I think it all comes back to your personal agenda. What is on your personal agenda, and how to pick out the right ways to spend your money. And I think that's what most people don't do. They just, they get so worried about what they have from a materialistic perspective, and they spend outrageously, or they get so focused on the money. I want to have more money. Either I need to invest all of it, I need to have no debt, right? And you can kind of become obsessed on those two opposite ends of, like, what you have in material things and what you have in your bank account, and forget the living that goes on in between. Mm-hmm. The living is what you need to take account of first, and then make your decisions off of the living. Yes, you're going to need to sacrifice, no doubt, because we've been taught to live at our means. Mm-hmm. So you need to learn how to unlearn that, to live beneath your means, but how far is a question of your personal lifestyle.
Okay, that's good advice. That is great advice. Now, I know we all saw with the pandemic in the last year, no one was prepared for the financial impact that happened last year. How can one prepare for any future disasters that would impact their income and their debt? How can they prepare for that?
Great question. So I think obviously some of this comes back to having a savings buffer. If you're listening to this and you're not someone that has credit card debt, you should build a 3-month bucket. What would a 3 months bought you during the pandemic? Time for that first stimulus payment. It would have bought you time for looking for a new online job. It would have bought you, right? So it would have bought you the time you needed to figure things out to double down on yourself during the pandemic while you're sitting at home, versus just being concerned that you couldn't go back to what you were doing. So 3 months doesn't buy you everything, but it at least gets you partway down the road. The other thing that you need to have kind of set up in place, so people weren't prepared for the pandemic in many ways. What happened if you were one of those people that didn't make it, like you didn't make it back alive? You died during the pandemic. What happened to your family that you now left behind? So I think from a planning perspective, not just considering, financially, what do you need to have in place? But I know you guys I've had other people on to talk about life insurance or disability or long-term care or different facets of the financial planning process that matter, that a pandemic highlights. It highlights what you've missed out on or what you haven't prioritized in your own planning process. And I think kind of going back through and recategorizing, how can I build a savings bucket? How can I live beneath my means? So if my means change, I'm not in trouble. How can I protect my assets if something happens to me or my spouse? What if it's just to the spouse that makes the most money and the lifestyle you're expecting is for a $500,000 house and now you can only afford a $200,000? So I think you've got to start thinking through the what ifs and start putting different tactics in play just in case something bad happens. Because for most of us, it's not if something bad happens, it's when. Some bad things happen, that's a part of life, whether it's death, disability, different things like that. However, you can put things in place to leave your family in good shape, no matter if those happen or not. So that's kind of the thinking you need to go back to the drawing board with. As much as a CEO of a Fortune 500 company thinks about his company because it matters, you need to think about your own family with that same intention. This is a multi-million dollar company. You think about all the money you're going to spend through your whole life. It's millions of dollars. You are a multi-million dollar CEO, and you need to think about it with that type of care on how you want to plan your life.
So pretty much you the CEO of your life, and you need to have that mindset. I like that. I'm going to have to tweet that.
I know, it's speaking that. That's a great quote, isn't it?
Yeah, I'm going to have to tweet that.
And so, for most clients, what I say is I kind of come in and help as sit as like a COO or a CFO, right? Where I come in and I offer like, okay, we don't have the right person in this seat over here or this person as an advisory board for you and your family. So like you need a good advisory board around you. We all have one, right? It might be your mom and dad. It might be your uncle, your cousin, your brother, your whoever you work with that you're getting advice from. You've by happenstance put them on your board, or you have selected them because you've thought through it. So again, if you see yourself as the CEO of your own company, you're going to think through who you have on that advisory board and say, should I trust the advice I'm getting from Uncle Bob, or is there a better source for me to get this information?
Absolutely, absolutely. Ooh, no, we can't trust none of my uncles. Take their advice. So how is transferring credit card balances helping one's debt?
So it doesn't really help a debt perspective. What it helps from is it gives you a period of time, usually with a zero interest rate. So that's most helpful when you're trying, if you think you can pay off that debt within that zero interest time frame, right? So it gives you a fixed number that's not escalating. If you have a 25% credit card, right, where every time you swipe, that company is going to make an extra 25% of what you just spent. So every $100 is worth $125 to them. If you roll that over to a zero interest balance and you can pay everything off within the time frame that it's zero interest, it can be, keyword asterisk, can be beneficial. The problem is usually we do that and then don't pay it off. And then that all that interest tacks back on top at the end. So it was not beneficial and it did not help. So this goes back to having a strategy and a plan before you employ something like that, just as like a, I've heard it's a good idea from Uncle Bob and I did it. And now look, I've got more debt at the end of this year and a half of 18 months interest free. So again, have a strategy going into that. If you're going to utilize it, it can help. If that's you and you have high interest rates and you get an introductory offer and have the means to pay it off in that time frame.
Okay. I'm so glad you said that, because I don't think a lot of people realize that time period that they waited, that 18 months interest-free or 2 years, whatever that is, that it doesn't go away. So if you don't pay it off, then it all comes full circle that you owe it. I think people don't always get that. They think I've got this, you know, 2, 3, 5 years. Oh, well, I didn't pay it. Now I'll just start payments on it today.
I'll just roll it over to a new one.
Yeah, without thinking, no, you've created 5 years worth of debt.
Yeah, the debt's like doubled. The debt's like tripled, really. Yeah. That is, yeah, yeah. And I had one of those cards and I followed, because the lady told me, she said, you want to pay this off, She said, you want to pay your balance before the term ends. Because if you don't, you're going to have like almost triple the debt. And I paid it off in like 6 months. I was like, nah, I'll pay off in 6 months. And I did it in 6 months. And you know what they did? They increased my limit. I was like, I don't need an increased limit.
That doesn't actually hurt you from a credit perspective.
Okay.
Because again, you're going to be judged. So when you go for a home loan application, they're going to look at your debt ratio. So if you've got $1,000 in credit because you just swiped for an airline ticket and a $10,000 limit, you're using 10% of your credit. But if you've used $1,000 on $30,000, it looks a lot better. So sometimes having a credit limit that you don't use is okay from an application standpoint.
Okay.
Utilizing your credit limit is not an option. So you want to have a good limit, right? But you don't really want to use that limit for anything.
Okay. Okay. So, and that's what I'm doing. Cause Ian's like, I charge and I have this mindset. Okay. And I tell myself, okay, can you pay this off in 30 days? If you can't pay this off in 30 days, don't pay it. Just, you know, pay cash. But I have a rewards so I want them points. So I'll swipe it. Then I'm like, okay, I'm gonna pay this off in 30 days and I'll pay it off.
You're bringing up a great point. So for most people, getting a card for points is a terrible idea.
Is it? Oh, wow.
Because of what you just said, can I pay this off in 30 days? That was your starting question.
Yep.
Did you start with how much do I need to save this month?
Mm-hmm.
Or how much do I need to have in my buffer account? Or how much did I invest into my retirement? Or, right, you're starting with the wrong question. So now you're already thinking of spending what you can make.
Yeah.
You're teaching yourself to spend what you're making rather than purposefully dedicating money to things. So again, just based on what you said, that's what a lot of people get messed up. And sometimes they think they can pay it off. And then it's, you know, what's an extra Starbucks and an extra Taco Bell run going to cost me? And sometimes that's what kicks you down this path to 10,000 limit just sitting on your card long term. So it sounds really easy to get the points. Most people don't have the discipline because they didn't do the other steps first.
Yeah.
Once all the other stuff is done and you have the discipline, then yes, it can be beneficial. Mm-hmm. But for most people, I don't recommend that as an option until they have disciplined themselves and all the other stuff.
Absolutely. Because, and you know, and I really learned most of that this year. Like when I got my bonus, like we get a bonus. And I was like, okay, I'm gonna pay off my credit card. Cause I used it last year. You know, I was like, okay, let me pay my credit card off. Paid that off. They gave me another increase. And I was like, So whatever. So I make sure I'm, you know, charging something, even if it's something like if I buy a book or something, because I know if I don't use it, your account goes dormant, they close it. And that's a bad thing.
Right, but you don't need to use it every month. You could use it once every 3 or 6 months. You can do a swipe for one thing, and that counts.
Oh, okay.
As long as you swiped it, they're not going to be mad at you. It's only if you like let it go for a year and you never use it.
Okay.
So you do want to swipe it like, you know, once a quarter, you're probably safe. Do an A swipe.
Okay. Well, I put some reoccurring on there. So I it's something always coming out and it's, I pay it off. But I realized before when I used to just pay a lump sum, I was like, man, I could have put that in my savings or I could have put that over here, but I just gave it all to the credit card. So only so that I wouldn't have to pay any interest. You know what I mean?
Right.
But I saw that I missed the window.
And going back to questions that we were asked earlier, where you were saying like, how do you get out of debt faster? Or how do you build that savings?
Mm-hmm.
It's instead of having an agenda for your tax return or for a bonus from work or from a gift from family to go spend on a material thing or an experience even, sometimes it's better to take that and invest it or pay something down.
Okay.
So you had the right mindset on that 100%.
Okay, good. That's good to know. So how do you help clients pay off their debt and what do, how do you help your clients pay off your debt? Because the other part of the question Pillara asked, you kind of asked that already.
Yeah, so in for Advocate Wealth, it is a part of our planning process is the budgeting. So like I said, we use a software. I meet with most of the clients that are financial planning clients, I'm meeting with every 2 or 3 weeks. So we are updating your budget monthly. So you have someone that you know is going to hold you to the grindstone about what you said mattered, mm-hmm. how what we said we wanted to spend money on. So like I have clients that celebrate with me when they don't spend money. I have clients that are like, oh no, we have to tell Sean that we bought something we shouldn't have. Like, so it's in the back of their mind. It's at least a second layer of like incentive and protection for them that someone is there holding their hand, keeping them accountable to themselves, not to what I said mattered, not to my agenda. We create an agenda for you and then walk you through a process to get where you want to go. Okay. So like I've had clients in the past year that if one had $60,000 of credit card debt, one had 35, both of them are debt-free a year out.
Nice.
So it is possible, depending on what you're willing to do, depending on what you have in your situation, that is not a wholesale, we can get everyone out of debt in a year. It all depends on your situation, but there is a path to get there. And so that's what whether it's the investing in the wealth planning side or hey, I just need a strategy for getting out of what I'm in, we help people with that as well.
Okay. Pillara, you wanna ask? We got time for the bonus question.
Okay, all right, just looking at the clock. Okay, so John, our bonus question for you. This is probably top of mind for a lot of people right now, especially coming out of the pandemic. I know we've talked a lot about student loan debt, but the whole idea of possibly forgiving some of the debt. So the Biden administration right now is toying with the idea of somewhere between $10,000 to $50,000 worth of student loan debt forgiveness. Do you have any opinions about that? Do you think that that's something that will actually come to fruition? I'm sure you have lots of clients that would love for it to come.
Yeah, so I don't have an opinion on it now. Political stuff in my world, I kind of wait, watch, pay attention, make a best estimate and plan accordingly. So when it comes to something like this, if we are going to hold on to some debt in case it gets forgiven, the number that I have given clients is $10,000. So if you're someone that's paying off debt and you've got $30,000 of debt, you're just like, well, I'm not going to worry about it because they're going to forgive it. Well, you might want to hold up there, right? We just had a president that was in there for 4 years. We might have another president that's in there for 4 years. So whatever agenda was...
Mm-hmm.
Way down to 10,000, but I would just continue to plan to pay it. And if you get, and if you know.
Okay.
You're going to benefit in some, the number that I've gone with for clients has been $10,000.
All right. Be conservative. That's what I'm hearing. So
be conservative, but if you are going to save a portion, save about 10K. Don't save any more than that to the government to pay for it.
Okay. And the question that my friend texts me, she wants to know, this is from the investment podcast. So she doesn't have any debt. She's recently divorced. Paying off the debt was a part of her divorce settlement. Very smart girl. they have 5 kids. So now she wants to start saving. I mean, not saving, she wants to start investing. And she want to know, is there such a thing? Because her job doesn't offer a 401k plan or a pension plan. So she has nothing. She gets half of her soon to be ex's pension, but she doesn't have a pension or 401k. What advice would you give her that she needs to, what would be your recommendation that she can start investing in to start building something for herself? She's 46.
Yeah, so I would think of it more as like a tool belt, right? There's not one solution that's going to solve the problem. I think she needs to think through a couple of different options. So number one, when that pension payment does come out to her, she'll be able to put that into a retirement account of her own. called an individual retirement account, an IRA. She can invest that however she'd like, and she can add $6,000 to that every year. So that's one bucketed option that she'll have available to her. She could do a Roth, depending on her income level. A Roth option is something that is you pay taxes on now and you don't pay any taxes on in the future. A third bucket would be like a taxable bucket. Like I was talking about before, is more of a utility knife. It's investing today, you could use it today. And you, what you would pay on that from a tax perspective would be capital gains. If she wanted to do something for the kid, that would be the 529 plan, right? So you can already hear there's a laundry list of options that we're looking at. There's not one thing. Again, what about her kids if she doesn't, she's not able to build a cachet of money now? What's her plan for those five kids now? Mm-hmm. Life insurance. So there's a list of things that she would want to work through. And again, that goes back to her priorities, her vision for her life. What is everything going to look like? But I would say think more of a utility belt and starting up a couple of options, maybe like one or two to start that you're going to focus on, and then try to start building them out over time. As you kind of continue to build wealth, you end up having all these options on the belt working simultaneously.
Okay. Okay. Because she got a lot of people in her ear and they're giving her, go to E-Trade and invest in this and this and this stock, Nike and Apple and all this. And, you know, because, you know, she has some money coming. And so there's a lot of people in her ear. And I sent her the link to the podcast to listen to the podcast, as well as your information. Because I think now is the time for her to reach out to someone instead of listening to everybody else in her ear.
100%. 100%. It's the best time because, again, what qualifications are people giving advice from? We all know Google attorneys, right? Unlike Pillara, who's a real attorney. If I'm going to trust a Google attorney or Pillara, it's Pillara all day long, right? Not even a question. We all know Google doctors. I'm not taking a prescription from them either. So you just want to make sure the person giving you advice is qualified to give you that advice. And whoever's giving you advice, again, is not telling you what you have to do.
Right.
They're giving you a recommendation based on your situation, saying, here's what I think would be best. Go back and do your own research based on what I'm saying. Go get a second opinion if you want, and then make mm-hmm. a decision. But I think that's the best way to do it, is to go get some qualified advice through sources maybe you trust. So a lot of my clients come from referrals of other people that have had a good experience. They've been through, you know, they're invested with us, or they're doing financial planning with us, and they've worked with us for a while. That's where the majority of our clients come from. I don't do a lot of advertising because we do a great job of taking care of our clients. And from that, we've built a successful business. And that's kind of what we focus on over here.
That's good. That's really good. That is really good. Well, Shawn, thank you for taking the time out of your schedule to join Sisters Conversation to discuss debt and budgeting. It is so important. And if you want to give our listeners a little tip or advice or closing remarks about the show today, go right ahead.
Yeah, so I would just reiterate a couple things. Number one, live beneath your means. Build a savings bucket. Think of, once you're out of the debt cycle, of investing in a tool belt fashion where you have multiple tools working for your benefit and for your family's benefit in the future. And that you're taking into consideration the gaps, whether that's insurance or estate planning or other things that you need to have in place that aren't covered just by having a bucket of money set aside just in case you need it. So that would be my overall advice. And you can reach out to me if Letrise or Pillara have my information to give out, and I'm sure they'll put it in the details as well. Feel free to reach out if you would like to talk through specific advice.
All right. Pillara.
Thank you guys for having me.
It's always a pleasure. You always give such great information. And so really appreciate having you on.
It's a pleasure to be here.
Pillara, any closing remarks that you want to add before we wrap up?
Well, I don't have much to add. I mean, I think Shawn really hit it right there on his ending remarks, making sure that you're looking at the total picture. And, you know, part of that total picture is what he talked about would be some estate planning in there. So I don't want to end the show without at least doing that a little bit, but that's part of all of it. So when you're looking at your finances, but you're also looking at what that estate planning piece looks like, because there are some gaps in there. And so look long-term and look at the whole.
Absolutely. Well, guys, there you have it. Some great advice. This show We'll also have the links to Shawn's website, his Facebook page, and you can reach out to him. He said he will, you know, if you guys reach out to myself or Pillara, we can send you your information to Shawn, and he can email you the Excel schedule that he said that he has. But I prefer for you guys to reach out to him directly so that you can sit down and have a conversation with him and talk to him about, you know, what you want to do. Because I think it's best to talk with the expert himself instead of me and Pillara trying to give you guidance. It's best in your best interest. I mean, he has a wealth of knowledge for you, and it's going to be to your benefit. We are here to empower you, to inform you, to educate you, and to advise you. But at the end of the day, you have a choice to make. And we want you guys to enjoy yourself. Welcome to July, and be safe and be productive and make right decisions. Until next time, this is Sister's Place signing off. Guys, be blessed.
Thanks to our special guests for joining the show today. Be sure to follow us on your favorite streaming channel so you don't miss a show. We can be heard on Spotify, Apple, iHeartRadio, Spreaker, and YouTube at Sister's Place. Visit our website, www.sistersplace.com, to learn more about us.